This collection of six characters in a single column of a computer printout of data from a radio telescope in Delaware, Ohio, is one of the most mysterious signals we've ever received from deep space, and it has baffled space enthusiasts for over four decades. This is the WOW signal. It was a warm summer day on August 15, 1977, when Jerry Eamon sat down for yet another routine shift of data analysis. As a volunteer researcher at Ohio State University's Big Ear Radio Observatory, Jerry's task was simple yet monumental: to scour through the endless stream of data searching for something that might indicate a signal from the stars. For Jerry, this would have been just a typical routine of data analysis, another set of numbers to review. But then, something caught his eye. A sequence that was unlike anything he'd ever seen before. If I were in his position, my heart would have skipped a beat at seeing the sequence of characters 6EQUJ5. In what must have been a thrilling moment, he picked up his red pen, circled the sequence, and then, almost instinctively, he wrote one simple word in the margin. WOW. If you're a little lost and confused as to why this is such an exciting and shocking signal, don't worry. Here's why this seemingly random arrangement of characters, 6EQUJ5, is so astonishing. Let's first talk about the telescope that received this signal. This is the Big Ear telescope. It's a radio telescope that, unlike the iconic parabolic dishes you might imagine when thinking of radio telescopes, is a flat reflector combined with a curved surface. Together, they formed a powerhouse of a telescope, offering sensitivity on par with a traditional dish nearly 53 meters in diameter, so almost as powerful as Mooriang, the Parkes radio telescope in Australia. But here's where it gets even more fascinating. The Big Ear was stationary, so instead of moving to look at objects in the sky like a dish-type radio telescope, it relied on the Earth's rotation to scan a fixed strip of the sky. This design meant that it only observed any given point in the sky for 72 seconds, which, coincidentally, was the exact duration of the WOW signal. Now, as for the sequence of characters in the WOW signal, each character corresponds to how many times stronger the radio signal was compared to the background radio noise in 10-second intervals. So a blank space indicates a signal intensity between 0 and 1 times the average background signal. Numbers 1 to 9 indicate the intensity from 1 to 9 times above the baseline, represented by the corresponding digit. And the letters A to Z go beyond 9 times above the average signal, indicating intensity from 10 to 35 times above the average background signal, represented by the corresponding letter. So A is for 10 to 11, B for 11 to 12, and so on. So for the WOW signal specifically, 6 means the signal was 6 to 7 times stronger than the background noise in that 10-minute measurement. E ramps us up to 14 to 15 times stronger. Q shoots even higher, 26 to 27 times stronger. U marks the peak with an intensity of over 30 times stronger than the noise, a massive signal spike. J shows a signal beginning to taper off at 19 to 20 times stronger than the background signal. And finally, 5 represents the signal fading back down to 5 to 6 times stronger than the background signal. This gradual increase and decrease in strength peaking at U reflects exactly what we'd expect to see from a steady signal source passing through the telescope's narrow observation window. And that's what makes the WOW signal so extraordinary, especially since its peak intensity was more than 30 times stronger than the usual background noise of deep space. No wonder it got that famous WOW from Jerry Eamon. So this alarmingly strong signal that seemingly came out of nowhere certainly baffled astronomers, and it did so for 5 key reasons. Firstly, the WOW signal was incredibly concentrated within a very narrow range of radio frequencies. Unlike the broad emissions we typically see from natural cosmic sources, this signal stood out like a clear station on a radio dial surrounded by static. This narrow focus is something we might expect from an engineered transmission designed to cut through the noise of the universe. Adding to the mystery, the signal's frequency was close to the 1420 megahertz emission line for hydrogen, the universe's most abundant element. Scientists have suggested for a long time that if an advanced civilization wanted to send a message, they might use this frequency, knowing that it would be universally recognized. It's like choosing the most common language in the universe to say, "Hello!" Thirdly, the WOW signal lasted for precisely 72 seconds, matching the time the Big Ear telescope could observe any given spot in the sky. Yet, despite countless attempts, this signal was never detected again. Its brief appearance left us with more questions than answers. Another puzzle the WOW signal left us was that it didn't carry any modulation or any sort of encoding that we could detect. No hidden message, no complex patterns. It's like receiving a postcard with just a splash of colour, but no words to tell you what it means. This lack of modulation is interesting because a deliberate message would likely have some way of conveying information. And finally, the WOW signal reached an intensity peak that was 30 times stronger than the average background noise of space. This dramatic spike in intensity is what really made it stand out, as if the universe suddenly shouted into the quiet, catching our attention in a big way. Another bonus complexity of figuring out the origin of the WOW signal lies in the design of the Big Ear telescope. It featured two feed horns, each picking up signals from slightly different locations in the sky. So while scientists could tell if a signal was detected by one or both feed horns, they couldn't determine which specific horn it came through. This setup, though innovative, added an element of mystery. Since the WOW signal was detected by only one horn, it left us with two possible locations of its origin. Given these fascinating features, it's no surprise that the WOW signal sparked a wave of hypotheses and debates among scientists and enthusiasts alike. So let's take a journey through the timeline of the theories that have emerged since the signal's detection. In the years following the detection, several hypotheses emerged to explain the WOW signal. The first and probably most exciting hypothesis was extraterrestrial intelligence. Given the signal's characteristics, the most exciting possibility was that it was an alien transmission. The idea of a signal from another civilization sent waves of excitement through the scientific community. Some scientists also explored natural astrophysical sources at this time, such as pulsars, stellar flares, or other cosmic phenomena. However, these natural sources struggled to account for the WOW signal's unique attributes, such as its narrow bandwidth and the sudden appearance of it. Another consideration was that the signal could have originated from Earth-based transmissions or reflections. We have seen that before, but while this was a plausible scenario, the specific properties of the signal and the design of the Big Ear telescope made this hypothesis unlikely. As the years went by, researchers continued to investigate alternative explanations. Some scientists proposed that a weaker, continuous signal may have been amplified by interstellar scintillation. Just like how stars seem to twinkle in the night sky due to our atmosphere, radio signals can experience a similar effect as they travel through the vast and uneven space between stars. This can cause the signal to vary in intensity, making it appear stronger or weaker over time. However, this hypothesis was later deemed improbable based on observations with more sensitive telescopes. Now, the idea that the signal could be a reflection from Earth-based transmissions of space debris gained some traction at this time, even by Jerry Eamon himself. Yet this hypothesis was eventually dismissed due to the unrealistic requirements of such a reflection to match the observed signal's properties. In more recent years, astronomers proposed that the WOW signal may have originated from hydrogen clouds surrounding two comets in the same region of the sky. Despite its initial appeal, this hypothesis faced significant challenges such as inconsistencies with the comets' positions, their weak emissions at the relevant frequencies, and the lack of detection in both the Big Ear's beams led to widespread rejection within the scientific community. As we can see, each hypothesis brought its own set of possibilities and challenges. While the mystery of the WOW signal continues to captivate and intrigue, recent developments have offered new perspectives and potential explanations. So let's dive into the latest research that sheds light on this mysterious signal and explore whether we're closer to solving this cosmic puzzle. Recently, a new paper popped up on Archive, a place where scientists in a number of fields, including physics and astrophysics, upload their research paper, whether accepted in journals or not, for public access. Abel Mendez and friends put together this paper and uploaded it to Archive, and now we all get to share in their science together. Now, before we get into their result, I want to stress that this paper has not gone through the peer review process, so it is subject to change depending on how it fares through that process. Their study proposes that the WOW signal might have originated from cold hydrogen clouds, which are vast diffuse regions of hydrogen in space, experiencing a temporary burst of brightness. Here's how they came to that result. Mendez and friends have been sifting through archive data from the Arecibo Observatory. Rest in peace. They're specifically looking at radio emissions from red dwarf stars between 2017 and 2020. During their investigation, they found signals strikingly similar to the WOW signal. While these signals were weaker, they shared some key characteristics, including that narrowband frequency around 1420 megahertz and a brief duration. They linked these signals to the cold hydrogen clouds within our galaxy near T Garden Star, a red dwarf star only 12 light years away. These clouds, because of the type of hydrogen that fills them, are known to emit radio waves at around 1420 megahertz. So, because of this similar signal, Mendez and Fred suggest that the WOW signal might have been generated when a cold hydrogen cloud was briefly illuminated by a powerful and temporary source. But this source comes with specific requirements. Because the wow signal was detected in such a narrowband frequency range, the event that supposedly stimulated the emission in a cold hydrogen cloud must not have altered the cloud's thermal or kinematic properties. If it had, the signal would have been broader and less focused. This constraint narrows down the possible sources to temporary events like a flare from a magnetar or a soft gamma ray repeater. Such events could excite the hydrogen cloud, causing it to emit additional photons specifically at the 1420 megahertz frequency without significantly changing the cloud's temperature or motion. The need for a precise alignment between the source of the radiation and the hydrogen cloud and Earth makes it a very rare event, which might explain why we haven't observed another similar signal in the last four decades. This new possible hypothesis offers a compelling natural explanation, moving away from the idea of an extraterrestrial origin. But it also sheds light on a potential source of false positives in the search for extraterrestrial intelligence, so it actually brings us closer to finding aliens in a roundabout way. While this hypothesis is intriguing, it's still under investigation. We need more research and observations to confirm if this is indeed the source of the wow signal. The search for similar events continues, and future observations with high-resolution radio telescopes might help us pinpoint the exact cause of this mysterious signal. Now, when I learned of this new research, I put out a short video briefly explaining the new result and asking you your questions about it. So let's answer them together. First up, from TikTok. How sure are we that it wasn't just an error blip? Was there enough redundancy to be sure this signal really happened? Great question. When we talk about the wow signal, one of the first things that comes to mind is whether it was just a simple glitch in the system. I mean, it was 1977. Technology was nowhere near advanced as it is today. But here's why this signal is so unique and why it's unlikely that it was just a machine error. First off, the wow signal wasn't just any random blip. It had some really distinctive characteristics that perfectly matched what you'd expect to see from a real signal coming from space as it passed through the Big Ears telescope observation window while the Earth rotated. Now, you might wonder if there were other similar errors back then. But the thing is, no other signal like the wow signal has ever been detected by the Big Ear or any other radio telescope from that era. If it were a common error, we'd probably have seen something similar pop up elsewhere, but we didn't. And sure, data processing back then wasn't as sophisticated as what we have now. The team was averaging signal intensities over 10-second intervals and comparing them to background noise, which is pretty straightforward stuff. But nothing about that process suggests it could have randomly generated such a unique signal. So while we can't 100% rule out the possibility of an error, all the evidence points towards the wow signal being a real astronomical event and not just a fluke or an error. But as with all good science, we need more research to confirm what it really was. Next, a question from Facebook. How old was the signal itself? When did the magnetic field in question actually flare? This is such a fascinating question, but unfortunately, the truth is, we don't know this yet. The physical source that triggered the wow signal, whether it was a magnetar flare, a soft gamma repeater, or something else entirely, hasn't been pinpointed. But here's what really excites me about this result and the mere existence of this paper. Now that we have this new hypothesis involving cold hydrogen clouds, we have a solid direction for future research. So with this new idea in mind, scientists can conduct more targeted searches for magnetars or soft gamma repeaters near the area where the wow signal was detected. Which brings me to the next question from TikTok. Are people constantly looking for certain data across all years detected to find things like this? The short answer is yes, absolutely. That's exactly what this team is doing. They're diving into historical data from the Arecibo Observatory, searching for signals that resemble the wow signal. It's like a treasure hunt through time, sifting through years of data to see if we've missed anything the first time around when we were searching for other things. Mendez and friends also plan to keep the Arecibo WOW project going by analyzing a massive collection of archival data that's now stored at the Texas Advanced Computing Center. So by re-examining this data with modern processing techniques, there's a chance that they could uncover more signals that were missed in previous analyses. But the work is far from over. While Mendez and friends propose a natural explanation for the WOW signal, they stress that there is need for more evidence. So by continuing to search for similar signals and correlating them with hydrogen clouds and potential energy sources like magnetars, they can test this hypothesis and piece together more of the puzzle that is the wow signal. It's honestly a great example of the long-term iterative process of science, especially in the field as complex and challenging as a search for extraterrestrial intelligence. Here's another one from Twitter. Have there been other examples of this phenomenon observed in the universe? Again, short answer is yes, but with a bit of a twist. The first astronomical stimulated emission of hydrogen was discovered in 1989 around the star MWC 349. This discovery was groundbreaking because it showed that stimulated emission could happen in space, specifically in environments containing hydrogen. But here's the thing. This one didn't emit light at the 1420 megahertz frequency. So what does this mean for the wow signal hypothesis? Well, the existence of these other stimulated emissions of hydrogen at different frequencies gives some credibility to the idea that the wow signal could have come from a similar process. However, if the wow signal was really a 1420 megahertz stimulated emission from a Magnetar flare or something similar, it would be the only known observation of such an event at that exact frequency. And finally, has this type of emission been created in lab conditions? Yes, actually. While we haven't observed stimulated emission at 1420 megahertz in space, they have been successfully created in laboratory conditions. And this is really cool because it tells us that there's no fundamental physical barrier stopping the stimulated emission of hydrogen at 1420 megahertz from existing. What this means is that if the right conditions were present, like those that might be caused by a Magnetar flare, stimulated emission at this specific frequency could happen in cold hydrogen clouds, just like it does in the lab. So while we're still looking for examples out there in the universe, the lab experiments give us confidence that it is definitely possible. And there you have it. The mystery of the wow signal continues to captivate us, raising new questions and pushing the boundaries of our understanding, from the unique characteristics of the signal to the exciting new hypotheses and ongoing research. It is clear that our exploration of the cosmos is far from over. If you've enjoyed diving into this mystery with me, make sure to subscribe and hit the notification bell so that you don't miss any future updates. I would love to hear your thoughts though. So what do you think about this new hypothesis and what other mysteries should we explore together? Drop your ideas in the comments and let's keep this conversation going. Stay curious, everyone, and keep looking up.